Hello everyone, I'm Katherine, and I'll be telling you about these three things: proofs about programs, proofs as programs, and programs as proofs. And as a bonus, you will also learn why there's a giant picture of a rooster on this slide. So, consider these two images. This is, the left one is from 1967, the right one is from today, basically. And it's not that important what the text says, but I want to kind of walk you through the development of, hey, I wrote an entire paper about proving this compiler correct, versus, hey, I used a computer to prove all of my transformations correct. So, all right, let's say you're a compiler. Great, so imagine being a compiler, and you get someone's code to look at and optimize. And so you see this strange piece of, like, this strange snippet of code inside that person's code, and you think, well, this could probably be optimized. So it looks like this. And you think, well, I don't really want to do the not operation. Maybe it'll save me one clock cycle. If I get rid of the not operation and just switch N2 and N1, that's probably the same, right? It'll save me time. Is that really the same? So you basically want to convince yourself that these two pieces of code are equal. And first, we need a definition of code equality. So let's just say, for every input, the output is the same for the two pieces of code. So for all intents and purposes, they're equal, even though there might be mutation and whatever going on. So if you're here, you can probably already do the proof for yourself in your head, but I want to walk people through it to see if we're right or wrong about these two being equal. So actually, let's just think about it first. So this x minus c condition here can either be true or false. And let's do a case analysis. If it's true, then great. If it's false, then great. It looks like they do return the same thing. So looking at the truth table, if you look down the true column, they both return N2. Looking down the false column, they both return N1. So we've convinced ourselves that these two if statements are basically equal. So great, this has an application in the real world, compiler optimizations. Sometimes it's not this easy. You might have pointers or mutations or something, but we just want to consider this simpler case and it'll generalize. So remember, you're still a compiler. We want to, all we did was convince our human selves on paper that this was probably correct. We want a computer to check that we're actually correct. Here's where the rooster comes in. So Koch is the name of an interactive theorem prover or proof assistant. It's called Koch because it was written by French people and they love roosters, the national mascot, so great. And one great thing about Koch is that, according to a category theorist, it is the world's best computer game. And you'll see that because we will now prove live that our code is the same. Exciting. So here's a refresher. Do you guys need the font to be larger?
Yes.
I don't actually know how to do that.
More like it's control plus if it's Zmax, might be
plus. Command plus.
Good?
Good. Yay!
Okay, great. So, quick refresher. We assert that these two are equal. Quick refresher on proof. We just analyzed the two cases. Don't worry about what this says. It's for later materials. So, let's look at the actual setup of the theorem. We assert that for all these variables, then basically exactly the two same things. And for the notation, the less than, just ignore the primes, I had to redefine some things. So, great. I'm not going to talk while I'm doing this proof so you guys can focus on reading it. So I know the text on the right is a bit small, but we will probably need the whole buffer for that. So on the right, we have the state, like what we have introduced so far, and on the bottom is what we want to prove currently. So we've got our first case done. Oh, by the way, the purple is called checking that everything you've done so far is correct, and that's the video game aspect of it. So great, everything is gone from the context, which means that we can write every mathematician's favorite word here, and it works. We've proven it. Great. So yes, that was our interlude. And so the first time I saw this, my mind was blown. I wanted to know, what is actually going on behind the scenes? What's the internal representation of the math inside? How does it know how to simplify things? Or like say, check that, oh, like this if had this condition, so I can just simplify it to n1, whatever. And so let's take a look at the internals briefly. So how does clock work? It's based on, first the name is based on COC, and COC stands for calculus of constructions. Don't worry too much about what that is. It's a generalization of a correspondence that we want to talk about here. So this correspondence, well, it's there's an interesting way that you can interpret your proofs as programs and your programs as proofs. So let's talk about kind of the most well-known part of this, or the most general part. So we have that a type corresponds to a proposition. I'm using corresponds to in kind of a colloquial, like non-rigorous way. So think of it as you have a one-to-one correspondence. You can match each one in one set with each one in another set. And the function that does this preserves the structure in some way. So let's consider a type, aj. So this means, if you know about Pascal, you'll be familiar with this. If not, it just means it's a function that takes something with a type a and returns something with a type a. Like maybe your function takes 3 and just returns 3 or something. So it would be from int to int. So one kind of function that might live inside this type would be, say, oh, if you gave me something of type A and I always return the same thing of type A, then clearly that does that and this function is inhabited or something lives inside it. So great, let's just say we have the identity function. And on the other hand, how are we going to interpret this as a proposition? So a proposition in math terms, or actually in more colloquial terms, is you have a bunch of hypotheses and you want to have some kind of ending goal. So one proposition might be, if it's raining outside, then I will get wet. That's one thing. And so if you interpret the arrows here as implication, then you would say, if A is true, then A is true, or if A, then A. So, great. We basically have a corresponding proposition for this type. And this is possibly a very simple example of the existing isomorphism. So, considering a more specific example, inside this A to A, we have something that lives inside it, a program that actually does that. That's the fx equals x. Similarly, for a to a, we have a proof that lives inside it, and it's just kind of like tautology. Like, we assume a was true, so it's true. Great. So let's actually inspect our own code and see kind of what it looks like. Sorry about the text being small. But yes, so over here we had our proof written in a kind of tactic language that Koch has to make things easy. And on the right, that's the representation in Galeno, which is what it looks like in Koch's internals, and it's a language very similar to ML. So you can actually see function, some arguments, natural number, and then some expressions that return things. So that's great, there's a proof embedded inside it. Some possible future directions, if you're interested in this. Oh, by the way, yes. The fancy name is the Curry-Howard isomorphism. I didn't say it at first because I didn't want to scare anyone off, but there it is. So yes, there's future work here. I would love to do a talk about each of these, maybe, but I have 23 seconds left, so yes. The most interesting application of Koch is that, not application, but implication, is that It's based on this interesting new kind of mathematics, and you should check out homotopy type theory. And I would also like to assert that clearly the most important application of POC is running the game 2048, which exists. And let me show you that first. Okay, I can actually show people who come up to me later, but it's great. You have this statement that says, there exists a sequence of moves such that 2048 is solvable, and then your proof is a sequence of moves like left, right, up, down. And then once you've actually gotten a 2048, you can say QED and it'll complete. So that's a very clear, it's not a perfect example of Curry Howard, but it's kind of an example of how a proof can be a program. Thanks.